Good morning, church, and welcome to this fourth Sunday in our Lenten season. A few weeks ago, Jesus started us by setting his face toward Jerusalem, toward the cross, and now we welcome him again into our lives with another great parable from the Gospel of Luke. God gathers us just as we are. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. We'll read responsively this Lenten litany. As darkness gives way to light and winter sleep to fresh beginnings, we come today to be reminded of God's love for us. Like the green shoots of renewed life stirring beneath the soil, we welcome an awakening of God's word in our lives. In this time of reflection and repentance, we affirm our identity, we claim our security as children of God. As Jesus sets his face toward Jerusalem, we too journey this Lent toward the cross. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the into a time now of confessing our sins, and that way we shed what is separating us from God, leaving our burdens and worries here at the foot of the cross, and receive God's forgiveness and renewal. First, let us confess together. Gracious God, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. Forgive us and give us strength to turn from sin and to serve you in newness of life. Amen. Church, by water and through the gift of the Holy Spirit, God gives us new birth. And through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God forgives us all of our sins. May Almighty God strengthen us in all goodness and keep us until eternal life. Amen.
please join me as we say the prayer of the day together. It is on the screen. God of life, death, and resurrection, during this Lenten journey, we follow Jesus to the cross to understand your deep love for us. May our lives reflect that resurrection matters in how we act today and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hello, kids. Welcome back to another Wednesday night worship. Please come join me up here. We are going to do something a little differently today. We have a skit that will talk about the Bible story today. And I have great little pictures so you can see who is talking, okay? Here we go. The narrator, this cute little guy, he says, "The rabble among them had a strong craving, and the Israelites also wept again and said..." Here's the congregation. They all speak together. "If only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we used to eat in Egypt for nothing, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up, and there is nothing at all but this manna to look at." Here's the narrator again. He says, "Moses heard the people weeping throughout their families, all at the entrances of their tents. Then the Lord became very angry, and Moses was displeased. So Moses said to the Lord..." Here's Moses. "Why have you treated your servant so badly? Why have I not found favor in your sight, that you lay the burden of all this people on me? Did I conceive all this people? Did I give birth to them? That you should say to me, 'Carry them in your bosom, as a nurse carries a sucking child, to the land that you promised on oath to their ancestors?' Where am I to get meat to give to all these people? For they come weeping to me and say, 'Give us meat to eat.' I am not able to carry all this people alone, for they are too heavy for me. If this is the way you are going to treat me, put me to death at once. If I have found favor in your sight, do not let me see my misery." The narrator says, "So the Lord said to Moses, 'Gather for me 70 of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people and officers over them. Bring them to the tent of meeting and have them take their place there with you.'" The narrator says, "So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered 70 elders of the people and placed them all around the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him, and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied, but they did not do so again. Two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad, and the spirit rested on them. They were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent. And so they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses." The young man ran up to Moses from the congregation, and he says, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." The narrator says, "And Joshua, son of Nun, the assistant of Moses, one of his chosen men, said..." Here's Joshua. Joshua, who had been standing off to the side near Moses, said, "My Lord Moses, stop them." And Moses says, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit on them." The end. That's our story today. Thanks for coming up.
We
this time, we'll pause our videos and be able to reflect on what God's abundance has blessed us with so we can bless one another. And so your tithes and offerings can be sent through the Rebel Give platform on our website, or you can mail checks in or drop them off here at the church as well. This morning at 10 a.m., we're going to have our parking lot worship at First Lutheran Church. You're welcome to join us there. And then we hope to be moving out to the fairgrounds soon so that we can gather more people and more cars. So please watch your mail and the e-news for that information. Next Sunday, March 21st, will be the first time we try an in-person worship gathering here in our sanctuary. That's going to be at 8:30 a.m. You'll need to pre-register starting Friday prior to that service. And there will be some instructions there, and then you'll get a reminder email. And we have a capacity of 75, so we'll start with that and see where that goes. It'll be good to see you. We'll continue our virtual worship as well as our parking lot worships as well. Just a reminder, too, about the sabbatical that is coming up for me. If you have any memories or pictures you'd like to have during this reflect time, you're welcome to submit that at sabbatical@calvarybemidji.org or see Nancy Schramm or Melissa Rickers. Now we have our second offering ministry partner, Jim Fretheim, who's going to share with us a little bit about Minnesota Food Share.
Well, thank you, Pastor. It's always good to be at Calvary Lutheran, and I'm here from your friends at the Food Shelf, and first of all, I want to thank the congregation for its historic and enthusiastic support of our ministry of meeting many of the needs of food insecurity in the Bemidji community, which are vast. The Food Shelf has been serving the community for 33 years, and last year, I just looked at our numbers in preparation for sharing with you folks. Your part of this is that we gave away last year 824,000 plus pounds of food in Bemidji. We had 12,524 households visit the Food Shelf. So you're part of a large enterprise, really. We had up to 700 volunteers in our organization. We're open Monday and Wednesday, and it's just a joy to serve people, and people are very enthusiastic about what has been done and what is doing. So how would you get involved? Well, you call our office, and we have a volunteer coordinator, Bev, who would be very happy to talk to you about volunteer opportunities of serving the public as they come. This is March, the month of March. This is Food Share month around the state. Minnesota has 332 food shelves. The Bemidji Food Shelf is the 15th largest. And we get help from a lot of different places, a lot of our local businesses, obviously, and churches like you. We're founded by seven churches 33 years ago. Now we have 17 churches, plus other organizations helping and supporting. So it's Food Share Month. What does that mean? It's our largest campaign of the year. You might be surprised to know that our biggest need of food is in the summer, not in the winter. People seem more inclined to give us money and food, which we're very grateful for, Thanksgiving, Christmas, and now during the season of Lent, certainly as well. We appreciate that. What we're really gearing for now is the summer, because kids are home from school and people just don't think of us and this kind of ministry as much in the summer as they do other times. So we'd encourage you to think about that, and Calvary's been a strong supporter again, as I said earlier. Our goal is to raise $100,000 and to collect 35,000 pounds of food during the month of March. So whatever you can do to help us achieve that goal, and as we reach out to help people, we would certainly appreciate it. If you come once and help, I think you'll appreciate what we do, and you'll think seriously about how important it is to do this. Just to remind you of this Lenten season, the Gospel of Matthew, the feeding of the 5,000, the disciples come to Jesus, and they say, "Lord, what are we going to do? How can we do this?" And he said, "Do not let them go away." And that's where we're at. We don't want to let the hungry people go away. We want to feed them, and I know you do as well. So thanks for the part that you have in helping us do that. May God bless you as you give and support and care for the needy and the broken in this community. Thank you.
Comes from a heart both frightened and free.
Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 16. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and who feasted scrumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. He called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. And send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus, in like manner, evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all of this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us." The rich man said, "Then, Father, I beg you to send him back to my father's house, for I have 5 brothers, that he may warn them, so that they will not also come into this place of torment." Abraham replied, "Your brothers have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them." And he said, "Oh no, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, then they will repent." And he said to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Church, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, here we are on the 4th Sunday of Lent, remembering again back on Ash Wednesday when we started this journey together that Jesus set his face toward Jerusalem, toward the cross, back in chapter 9. And at this point along the journey to Jerusalem, Jesus starts preparing us for his death. Now, this is a tough place for us to be. When you love someone, you're never ready to lose someone. So however one is facing death, cancer, COVID, addiction, or even when it's sudden and unexpected, we just don't do well. It crushes us, changes us, takes our breath away. Now, death is something that we will all face with all of our loved ones, and even for our own selves. So to hear Jesus trying to prepare us today for his death is tough. We don't really want Jesus to die. I mean, think about his obituary. This young man in his 30s, beloved by so many, so easy to talk to, helped a lot of people. And his death on a Friday that the church ironically calls good, Good Friday. We gather as a church still to this day like we do for all funerals, filled with grief and loss, wearing our black, and yet with anticipation, to hear a good news of the gift of the resurrection to breathe new life into our loved one. And for me, I wouldn't want to be at anyone's funeral without hearing about God's plan for them next, their resurrection. So Jesus meets us along our road of life today and tells us this story, this parable about a no-named rich man and a man living on the streets named Lazarus. Again, Luke, the gospel writer, puts us in this uncomfortable position of being the one in the story who is living the good life. Maybe that's why there's no name for this rich person. We are invited to step into their shoes and imagine that it is us inserting our own names. You and I have been given a good life. And yes, I hear you. Many would say, well, we earned this good life and we worked hard for it, which is true. But at the end of the day, we too are living the life like the rich man in this parable. Our obituaries, if we were to die, would sound much like Jesus's, talking about our birth and baptism, our education, the family life, work, hobbies. They would share stories about how we made friends, were fun to be around, how we enjoyed life, spent money and time, eating out, playing with expensive toys, traveling, all because we can. Yet many of our own obituaries miss the proclamation of the resurrection. I challenge you to change that. But it's true in life, we're given lots of choices, lots of options. And yet this Luke story is clearly a warning to you and to me to think about what it means to live a good life, having plenty. Those of us who can take care of ourselves and our loved ones and actually take good care of ourselves, not needing help from others, not accepting help from others, if we're capable of caring for ourselves and our family and our close friends so abundantly, why do we often not choose to spend our time and money on those in our communities that don't live the same lifestyle? We are the rich man or woman who sees Lazarus, actually knows him by name, and yet feel no responsibility to respond to their obvious needs. How about we ask the question in this way, just to reflect on our own lives in the season of Lent? How many street people in Bemidji would attend your funeral? Or think about how many people living on the margins you know by first name, those living in poverty, those who are hungry and don't quite have the same life you have. If no one comes to mind as you pause and look at your own life, I invite you to risk crossing that boundary in this season of Lent, making yourself uncomfortable, and try getting to know a person or two and risk caring for them because you can. Now, I know this is a hard challenge, it's a risky challenge, but it is an important one, understanding who we are and giving our purpose as Christians. And as we work individually on this challenge, I want to remind you that we also have a challenge as a church family. Calvary Lutheran, in this season of March, in the midst of Lent, have been given a challenge to raise $5,000 for our local food shelf. This money matters in March because that what we raise locally helps our local food shelf apply for greater funding. But they need to kind of show Bemidji and all the grant applications that they apply for that more that people than just who are at the food shelf care about the people in our community. If you and I feel that all people should be fed and nourished, then it's our responsibility to participate in helping them apply for these critical applications of money all throughout the year, showing that we as a faith community understand the need and will rise to the challenge the best we can to meet the needs of the Lazaruses in our own community. Now, often I hear people say we don't support the food shelf because there's a lot of people who are using the system, taking advantage of free food programs, and of course that's true. But does their survival behavior or use of the system choices, should that change what you and I are called to do? If there is a Lazarus in our community, we should notice them and do what we can for them instead of pass by with judgment or shame. They should not have the power to change you, these people who wonder if this is a good way to support our neighbors, because you and I probably can risk being taken advantage of, even sparing a few dollars or a hot meal or giving money to our local food shelf. Will you risk giving as generously as God has first given to you? Well, in today's world, the Lazarus as our own town aren't outside our doorstep literally. They aren't at the front door, but they are here. And it may be even simpler to give money to the food shelf, to an organization that we partnership, than finding a friend to feed yourself. But the whole reason why Jesus is telling us this story is he's preparing all of creation for his death and resurrection. Not so that we could mire in what is to come, to plan our funerals, to write our obituaries, to prepare, although that is something good too. He tells us the story so that we can live a good life here on earth and an abundant life in Christ. We gain a perspective that even though we too will die and rise again, our goal is not somehow to get into heaven or stay out of hell, but it is about living like Jesus did and watching how his death and resurrection change our everyday life and perspective. Getting to know the Lazaruses of Bemidji and or supporting our local food shelf are just a few examples of how we can live like Jesus' resurrection matters. When we have more than enough, we can share what we have with others, and especially the least of these in our communities. In this fourth Sunday of Lent, Jesus prepares us now for his death and resurrection. And he's also inspiring us to live life now to the best of our abilities. And when our needs are adequately and in most cases abundantly taken care of, it's our joy and our duty to help others. Not because we have to, but because we get to, because of what God has already done for us. That you and I can see and understand God's great plan for us, which does include our own death and resurrection, but is only to point us back to living life now, living life today with purpose, vitality, and joy. When we live out our identity as children of God by making sure all are fed, both with food and God's word, then we are living an abundant life Jesus came to give us. Today's gospel story is about the power of the resurrection and how we understand that future impact in our lives today and every day. May it be so. In Jesus' name, amen.
Seed of your word, Lord.
join me now as we read the Lenten Creed. We believe that our lives are held within the encircling love of God, who knows our names and recognizes our deepest needs. We believe that Christ is the divine child of the living God, and that his grace is like living waters that can never be exhausted. We believe in the birthing, renewing, enabling spirit of God who yearns over our welfare as a mother yearns for her child. We believe that God is in the arid desert as well as in green pastures, and that hard times and disciplines are also loving gifts. We believe that our journey has a purpose and a destination, and that our path leads to a human glory we cannot yet imagine. We believe that in the church, we are fellow pilgrims on the road, and that we are called to love one another as God loves us. This is our faith, and we are humbled to profess in Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Church, let's turn our hearts and minds to power of prayer. Let's pray. We thank you, God, for what you first gave to us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. We thank you for blessing us with not only enough, but blessing us with abundance, so that we may take care of ourselves adequately, abundantly. And now, Lord, with this excess, please help us to know that we can help the Lazaruses in our community find enough, that we can feed them through our smiles, through our waves, and through our sharing of our abundance. In this great Lenten challenge, Lord, may you guide us and bless us to reflect you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we gather today in this time of March and thanking you for the creation that you've provided us with. We thank you for the warmer weather and the sunshine, for the snow that still covers our earth. We thank you, God, in the change of seasons that we also feel change, that you continue to come and restore and renew us and all creation. Keep everyone safe, Lord, and away from harm, and bless your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we give you thanks for the many blessings we get to celebrate today. We thank you for birthdays and anniversaries celebrated within this faith community. We thank you for schools opening up, that you continue to have them be safe places for kids and students and staff to gather and to learn and to grow in who they are as community leaders. We also pray as businesses start to open up, Lord, that you continue to shield us from spreading COVID-19 to one another, especially those most vulnerable. We give you thanks, God, for the birth of Addison May Eichsted, born to Dylan and Logan. And we ask, God, that this new family be blessed with your love. For all these blessings, we give you thanks. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And God, we also think of those who are in need of your healing today, those who are in need of prayers, those who are sick, battling cancer, those feeling isolated, alone, depressed. We ask, God, for those who are facing surgery, that you bless them with your peace, and those who are awaiting test results, that you continue to guide them. Be with the doctors and nurses, dentists, staff, everyone who surrounds us in the medical profession to continue to help us be well. We give you thanks for these gifts. And may you bless us with your healing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we thank you for the nations, for the world. We pray for our brothers and sisters around the globe. We especially pray for those who are in need of clean water, food, shelter. We ask, God, that you continue to help us battle AIDS and malaria and preventable diseases, that all may know of your healing touch. For those who live the comfortable life around the globe, help open their eyes to see their neighbors in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, for all these prayers prayed out loud and prayed in the silence of our hearts, we lift before you. May you turn on our ears to now hear your response in whispering in our ears to direct us in our mission and ministry this week and always. And now hear us as we unite our voices sharing the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Next week, we continue this journey with our companion here, Luke, and the gospel writer, as we hear a very familiar story about Zacchaeus, and Sunday school and Bible school lessons are based on this story and how God continues to seek out and find us and restore us to God's community here on earth and in heaven. So Luke 18 and 19 next week. And I'll be sent off with this blessing. May the blessing of God Almighty, the wisdom and power of Christ Jesus, and the light of the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Oh, how good it is when the family of God dwells together in spirit, in faith and unity, where the bonds of peace, of acceptance and love are the fruit of His presence here among us. So with one voice we'll sing to the Lord, and with one heart we'll sing out His word, till the whole earth sees the Redeemer has come, for He dwells in the presence of His people.
In peace, sharing Christ's love with others. Thanks be to God.